Bon dia. Good morning.
Good morning. My name is Carlos Diez. I'm a teacher at the high school Quatre Canons in Poblenou, Cantons in Poblenou. And we look at industrial archaeology here at the high school Quatre Cantons del Poblenou. It was founded in 2011, 2012, and we have 515 pupils. Here it's at the center of this district, Poblenou, in Barcelona. Our neighborhood at the beginning of the 20th century was known as the Catalan Manchester. A lot of industries from different sectors, the textile, the metal industry, several industries all set up there. And this industrial activity led to just in 30 years, the number of companies increased greatly. Our external proposal for globalized work here in Poblenou, well, it's multiple proposals of different interventions where a company, an external organization, the pupils come along and they cover a need. In this case, it was the Pedagogical Resource Center in San Martí, and they asked a group of second and third year high school students to build a series of models of emblematic buildings in Poblenou and to design a website to offer information about the buildings themselves. They started by taking the real measurements of the buildings using Google Maps. They used a projection and they used the tool to measure the distance, and in that way they could determine these real measurements. And they would look at the facades and the different cladding of the facades. They used a tool which is called Genius Scan for iPad. And I was the professor in this case, and I thought I would explain the theories and carry out different operations. And one pupil said, "Teacher, that's not necessary. We've got an app which allows you to project a flat image and to get the real measurements without going through all of those theories." Subsequently, we had a three-day design using SketchUp. And this gives you an idea of what the final model would look like. And the pupils themselves showed me this. They decided to use a virtual walk through the building and include this in the website. When we had all the dimensions of the building, the pupils then used a tool called Rhino 3D to design the facades and different elements of the buildings, like the doors, the windows, the balconies, and the facades were built through a laser cutting tool. And we used the different tools that we have in this institute. And once we had the parts, the pupils built them. We used professional finishing for different textures for the models. They built the buildings. They then covered them with elements that they had built through 3D printing. And these are the final products that we can see here. So these are six models of the six emblematic buildings in our neighborhood.
Of Catalonia was the work of a master builder, Josep Manimón, as a project of a British company, Prince Smith.
Vale. L'alumnat també va pensar.
The pupils also thought that it would be interesting to include in the website three videos with this virtual walkthrough of the buildings in English, Catalan, and Spanish so that visitors could get to know the most relevant aspects of each building. The website can be accessed via its web address, of course, and via a tag where there's a QR code which can be captured using a smartphone. And in that way, you can access the website. And just in terms of a final conclusion, I would say that the pupils, well, I think they got really excited by this project. They were really involved. They were aware of the evolution of their neighborhood. They thought about how the urban landscape had changed. And all of this, well, they did the whole project with classroom technology.
Gracias. Muchas gracias.
Thank you very much. And now we will move on to the next one. And this is Francisco Salmeron from the high school, Joan Pallares y Pla, or the school.
Buen día.
Good morning. My name is Francisco Salmeron, the headmaster of the Johnson Resin Plant School, and I'm here to tell you about this project. This is a school in Sabadell with preferential learning, meaning that we have students that are quite mixed, quite diverse in their background. And to give you a quick overview, 19 different mother tongues with all its due diversity, not just from a cultural background, but also from an economic background. In this project, we wanted to have a quality integrating process because we wanted to prevent the digital divide and we wanted to provide ICTs for everyone. And we wanted to endow our school with computers that would really work and that could be used on a daily basis so that the lab was not necessary anymore. The four main areas are ICTs and in your usual classroom and not just in your lab, or in your just computer lab. The learning technologies available for other within everyone's reach, and we wanted to have a more power saving because it used to be the case that whenever we had our computers online, everything broke down, and then the use of learning technologies in Catalan. This was something in the use of ICTs and learning technologies that we wanted to provide because we did not want to have the computer as an exception, but rather as a daily tool to prevent the digital divide because they usually could only access computers by going to the computer shops. And they usually didn't have the possibility to go online when at home, or they may have some issues, economic issues, and this is why school became their computer reference. We also wanted to promote equal opportunities by building a fairer society, meaning being low cost doesn't mean low quality. Power saving, energy saving, because again, we have the need to be able to plug our computers without that meaning an tremendous effort in energy consumption for school. And we also worked on the Green School project with a more responsible use of technologies. And furthermore, we embraced the Ari Lliure program in Catalan. And in 2015, in our fifth grade course, we started with a classroom. Then on 2016, we included the secondary cycle. And then, in as much as we can, based on our budget, we will try and extend this to the whole school. For that, we required three things. Link hat, and we were quite fluent with it. We were able to mastery, the LTSP, and the Raspberry Pi. The Raspberry Pi, we did so because we were lacking money. Probably if we had money, we hadn't used it. This is Link Hat, you probably know it. We've been with Linkat for long. The LTSP, the Linux Terminal Server Project, is also a tool we used. And now to Raspberry Pi, which is something really tiny, like a smartphone, but where you can have a great number of computers with a lower price when compared to your usual desktop PCs. We now have like 35 devices and just like a smartphone size, as you can see. Investments. We used to pick up computers everywhere whenever a computer was handed out, and so that we could incorporate it in our computer labs. And then 65 euros just because of the Raspberry Pi, and then a screen plus mouse and keyboard, you would have a computer per student. And this is what we have. We have our computers in the classroom, not in the computer lab. We also have an IWB, an interactive whiteboard, and so that you can have a group working with computers, another group working with pen and paper, and then a different group might be working with the interactive digital board. I would say that it's been quite a positive experience and in an enhancement of basic skills. We have improved the achievement of the basic skills by students, and we've somehow breached the digital gap, or at least to shorten the digital divide. And now our older students going through primary courses with computers in their own classroom, they are unable to think about a classroom without a computer. And if anyone, and if any of them goes to a different part, different school, or if anyone comes from a different school, they are surprised to seeing computers in our classrooms. That's it. Thank you very much for your attention.
Moltes gràcies.
Thank you very much. Very interesting to be able to see a different usage of things. And now we will listen to Mr. Luis Planas from Aldestanja School in Platja d'Aro town.
Bon dia. Com deia Steve.
Just like Steve Jobs would say, everybody in this country should learn how to program a computer because it teaches you how to think. And this is the goal behind our project. I'm here on behalf of Aldestanja School in Platja d'Aro to launch. And we have a significant degree of immigration, like 40%, significant mobility also of our students. And yet, with teaching staff that's not, with not that much of a rotation. And we have the participation of all the teaching staff, or us working in robotics and computers, all the teachers, all the headmasters and tutors, and all students that have this passion for learning. We work on robotics because what we program in the virtual environment, in a computer, is something that they see on their real life. And it's something that you can see in their faces. So when you see that what they've programmed is performed by the robot. It all started as an initiative by the educational district of Valdaro, where they came to us with a proposal to have a science park at the Girona University. And there we realized that robotics could be really helpful to us. Back then, that summer, we were trained, three teachers of us were trained, and then in the next event, we were participating on the Lego League. We started with the higher education, but then on secondary education, but then we realized that these had to be brought down to the lower classrooms. And hence, we created these, where all courses had to go through robotics. Robotics are included within computers. It's not always ICTs or computers, but some quarters we do. We have a weekly session with split groups, and we also choose like 10 to 15 students with good attitude and good performance, and they are part of this advanced set of excellence. And when working on problem solving and arts, they also work on advanced robotics, and they work on projects such as Experimenta and then some others. We have advanced SEPs and math SEPs, and these advanced robotics groups, they also have these SEPs. And now for a short video where we can tell you a bit about the robots we've worked with. In children's education and in primary education, they use the bodyguard. They start with the first sequencing in programming, and they use this robot, quite similar to pivot, but then introducing repetitions and angles. Then they use code in third grade. These are challenges that are becoming more and more difficult, and they need to program. Then in the fourth grade, they start building their own first robots with a Lego build with engines and sensors. Later on, they will program this through Scratch. Then for higher education, secondary education, they use the Lego Mindstorms, more complicated robots. We also work on 3D printing and 3D design. And the most advanced students in maths, they prepare themselves for the first Lego League, and we can see them how they were preparing for this Lego League last year. And they were so impressed by these, so they asked the parent teachers associations, so that once they were in high school, they could continue with robotics. And we've organized such a scheme, and we've made some huge achievements, I would say, both local and internationally. Of course, you need to assess these, and here you can see the outcomes for the math skills with a significant improvement. Of course, it cannot all be attributed to robotics. There are other things, but I would say that at least robotics is supporting us. You could also look at the different milestones we have attained, both with school teams, but also after school teams. And back to my starting quote, where some children were asked what they wanted to be when they grew up. Some said teacher, some said doctor, some said chef. And when asked what a software programmer was, many of them did not know. And last week, I asked my pupils about that. And when I asked them, what would you like to study? I would like to work on programming or software development. And well, considering that most of the jobs in the future will have to do with the new technologies, I would say that at least we've broadened up their views. Thank you.
Muchas gracias.
Thank you very much. And as I was telling you, we will now listen to these parent teachers association, and with Enrique Casasas, school from Sabadell. You have the floor. Good morning. I'll tell you what we've done at the Parent Teachers Association and how we have intervened in the classroom. Let me tell you that first, we are a school from Sabadell, like 20 miles from Barcelona, and we believe it was important to work along with the teaching staff in order to introduce some programming into the classroom. We came up with the proposals to be incorporated in the curriculum, even though it was more complicated to us because of the school job balance or conciliation, but we did so because we wanted this to benefit all students. Let me tell you about this project first. It was titled Animal Teu Nom, liven up your name or animate your name. And then the approach here was to teach students how to program with a given challenge. So they had to choose the name of a fourth grader, and they had to pick a rhyming term with that name, and then using Scratch, that they had not used before, they learned how to program with Scratch by animating the letters in that name. And this is the set of instructions we prepared for them, explaining them what to do. And then they partnered in pairs, and still they animated letters, introducing songs, sizing them up, changing colors. So they found out what can be done with Scratch, close to everything. And they found about these as they were imagining what they wanted to do with these, with those letters. Here you can see some of the animated words. And what happened next? Well, second graders, they went to the classroom at P4, and they were really so happy about it, so proud that they had prepared that based on their name. And then these children at preschool, they were tapping on their own letters, and the letters jumped around or shifted or moved. So it was something that for preschoolers was nice, because they were starting to learn to read. And then the second graders were really excited to see the outcome. And this is something that we often do by mixing primary students with preschoolers or students from minor courses. And then the maze game that we did this year, where also through Scratch and couples, they had to design a maze circuit by implementing all the game mechanics. So you had a character figure that had to go through the maze. So first you need to have the keys moving that character, and they had to learn how to create that video game. And also the mechanics, and here are just some examples, like what would happen if I would leave the maze. If you leave the maze, you need to go back to the starting point, and they had to do so. And there was some bleeping sounds in some of them, like, "Wang, you got it wrong." So if they got it right, there should be a different sound, like an applause or something. And they really enjoyed it. And indeed, we also enjoyed preparing this project for them. And it's really rewarding when you see that even after the class is finished, they don't want to have the school break. So when you see this, is something that really feel passionate about. Then, different activity for the older students, for sixth graders. We by resorting to an existing strategy game, so that they could learn some math concepts that, if learned through tradition, it might be more difficult, like managing resources you have, saving up when required, percentages, and what a percentage is, and so on. So by playing this video game, they would learn this with a hands-on approach. And concepts that are in the curriculum of these great. Here is a screenshot of this video game, Vector Tower Defense, which would look like just a bug killer game. But here you have these resources, these towers here. They all have a different features, and you need to place them along their path so that they cannot reach the end. So you might think that this is just yet another video game, but it provides you with indicators that you can work with them in the classroom. So first we gave them some time so that they could play around with it, and then when they had finished playing, we approached them with a series of math questions based on their experience with the game, like percentages or problem solving. So the video game became an environment, a complex environment, with the aim to solve math problems or optimizing resources. Another video game that we also used for fourth graders is like a jigsaw, and we use this mostly for geometry, and we related the 2D with the 3Ds. And you will see later that on a screenshot, but this helped us work on location, shifts, representation of paths, geometry, and this is a screenshot. You are a beach ball that needs to find its way until finally getting the key and to leave this. So first we gave them some time for playing, and then on the real world, on the offline world, you would like this platform with these geometric shapes. So now you try and mimic these with real pieces, and they had to do so. And once they had done this, after working on geometry, they had to come up with new levels, new geometrical forms, and coming up with different paths so that on the offline world, they would use different screens and different levels for this video game. And this was just the beginning, because we have now set up an activity for parents in after schools. And this is something that we'll be doing tomorrow, where we will be inviting families that have registered before, and they will come with their children. They will be in partners, and we will teach them about Scratch so that parents themselves can learn about what their kids have learned in school. So, because being a mother, you may think, well, if a kid is playing a video game, you might think that he or she is like isolated. No, this is seeing it the other way around. So let's both parents and children make a video game, develop a video game. So all in all, we are so proud with these activities, with these experiences we've done in the classroom, always with the cooperation of the teaching staff. And also, these proposals have energized the students that where these issues, these math issues and problems that we've seen before, they were really interested in it, and they've seen that how this is a good approach at working with these topics, with these concepts. And also, I mean, getting it wrong, it's not a problem. I mean, they can see that there's an error, that it's a mistake. And so to see how they can progress, they learn also by trial and error every now and then. They partner, they cooperate, they had to share their knowledge. They were all providing their views on how to better solve the challenges put up by the video game. And we are also happy that these experiences that we have reported and we have documented have been helpful in launching the ICTs in the school's classrooms. And they can be reiterated every different course, not for us parents to be there and teach them, but rather teachers now learning and repeating this through the several courses. Thank you.